Moving ahead with section 4.4, which is on technical progress. Now, this is something that we have already come across in the solo model, but in the solo model, we didn't really explain this in detail. We just said that there's some exogenous factor at which we can say that there will be persistent growth in the per capita level of income and capital, and this is what it is. But we didn't really get into the details of what really is technical progress. And reiterating the same things in these paragraphs where we talk about how in the existence of how when we assume that there is some fixed factor of production such as unskilled labor or land, if we postulate that production is constant returns to scale in all factors taken together, then sustained growth becomes difficult to explain without the existence of continued increase in the body of knowledge, which is what is being explained by technical progress. So if we say that there is an existence of some fixed factor of production, irrespective of the fact that you have physical capital alone or you have physical and human capital both in the production function, if there is a presence of fixed factor of production, then there will be and if we assume that the production function follows constant returns to scale in all the factors together, then there will be diminishing growth effects, and it becomes difficult to explain sustained growth effects, because ultimately if there is diminishing returns to factor, then it brings back to the same analysis of solo model that you will only have growth rates in the short run till you reach the steady state value, and once you reach the steady state value, there will be no growth effects. So in this kind of situation, it becomes difficult to explain sustained growth, and it's only because of this, we can only explain this sustained increase or sustained growth by believing that there is some existence of continued increases in the body of knowledge. So if you remember, I told you that when we were discussing technical progress in the solo model, that the meaning of the technical progress here is that there will be a shift, an upward, a consistent shift in the production function, a consistent upward shift in the production function that will sort of change the steady state value consistently, and the economy will grow, and you can explain the sustained effects. So it is only dependent on the existence of continued increases in body of knowledge that we can explain sustained increases or sustained growth effects in such situations. So in this model, in the human capital model, we are assuming that physical and human capital together exhibit constant returns, right? Because we are sort of assuming, we are dropping the effects of fixed factors of unskilled labor in our production function, and we are saying that there's constant returns in all inputs that we are accumulating in the production function, that is physical capital and the human capital. So if we assume constant returns, then we can say that there will be endogenous growth, which is, and we don't really need an exogenous growth effect. That is something that we needed in the solo model. So if we are saying that the production function follows constant returns in inputs, then endogenous growth theories are sufficient, and we can say that similar to the human capital model, that the economy will grow at some S alpha Q1 minus alpha growth rate, and this is the sustained growth rate, right? This doesn't stop at one point of time. This is a sustained growth effect. Similarly, in Haradomar model also, we said that the economy will grow at S by theta, and that is a sustained effect, right? But if there are theories which postulate diminishing returns because of some non-accumulable factor of production, which is fixed factor of production, then we have to ultimately rely on some kind of exogenous factor such as technical progress or something similar on similar lines to generate growth. So two kinds of theories. One is endogenous growth theory, where we are assuming that the ultimate or the sustained growth is explained by the endogenous variables, such as the Harrod model or the endogenous growth theories that we are discussing right now. Because in both these growth theories, we are saying that the sustained growth effects will be explained by parameters that are in the model, that are endogenous. So savings and capital output ratio in the Harrod model, or Q and S in this model, where Q and S are both savings rate going into human capital and physical capital. But if we are in a production setup where we are assuming diminishing returns to factor, then there we will have to ultimately rely on something that is exogenous. similar to what we did in the solar bottle. So it's important to understand technical progress, because I mean, you may not always have favorable situations where we can get rid of the fact that there is some fixed factor of production. So the next section basically talks about this technological progress and what do we really mean by technological progress, and what forms can we represent technological progress. So broadly, in this chapter, we are classifying technological progress into two categories. First is those gains in knowledge that are created by deliberate diversion of resources from current productive activity in the hope that they will result in profitable production in the future. So basically, spending some time deliberately, you are deciding into your preferences that you want to sort of trade off your present with your future. So by producing lesser today, you want to produce more in the future. And so basically, what do? You invest in research and development, you invest in time, you put in some money into understanding what could be the newer innovations in the production technology or maybe in the product itself that could lead to more efficient production in the future. So first method of technological progress is that you attain knowledge by trading off your present with your future. So these innovations may be in the form of new products, which is called as product innovation. Newer products come into existence, or it could be introduction of newer methods of production. So production processes change. So maybe you build a more efficient method of producing the same product, which would be called as the process innovation, or you build a new product in itself. And we know that both has been happening around us. We know that there has been a lot of changes in the kind of products that we use. There has been a lot of introduction of technology in the kinds of products that we use. More automated products are being introduced, these days. So this is the category where we say that there has been product innovation. And the other kind of category could be that you build the same product that we have been using since past, but you build it more efficiently. I mean, you introduce maybe newer technologies, more efficient technologies to pace up the production of the same product. So this could happen in two ways. One is product innovation or the process innovation. And this is a deliberate diversion of resources from the present to the future. Because definitely, if you are allocating a part of your population, a part of your labor force into research, then definitely these people would not be able to contribute to the current production process. Right. So if there's a set of people who are working, who are researching on something, then they will only be, their efforts will only go into research and development. They won't be able to contribute to the present production needs. So in that sense, we are sort of trading off our present production needs with the future production needs, because we believe that if they are spending some time in research, then we expect that that will help us in the future. So the first category could be this. The second is transfer of technical knowledge. Remember that this is generation of knowledge. You are generating the knowledge by yourself. The other is transfer of technical knowledge that occurs from the innovating firm or a core of innovating firms to the rest of the world. So in this kind of technical progress, what's happening is that we are not really getting invested into R&D. What we are really doing is that we are importing. We are relying on someone else's development. So in most cases, developed economies are obviously more technologically advanced than developing economies. And if the transfer of technical knowledge is free, then the developing firms or the rest of the world will sort of copy the kind of processes that these developed nations have adopted. So transfer of technical knowledge from the innovating firm or a set of innovating firms to the rest of the world. This is called as diffusion of knowledge. And this can be again of two types. The first is that the new technology become known to outsiders who can then profit from it directly. or the new technology may lay the groundwork for other innovative activities, not necessarily by the individual or the organization that carried out the original innovation. So this diffusion can actually occur in two forms. One is that it becomes available to outsiders, and the outsiders use it in the same form. So one is that possibility, and the second is that they innovate further on these technologies, so that becomes the groundwork for them. The technology that someone else has developed, it becomes groundwork for the ones who are now developing the same technology further. So this could occur in two forms, but definitely the diffusion, in the diffusion process, you are not working from scratch. You are taking some kind of you are taking some kind of motivation from outside, either in the direct form, or you are further adding your own originality to the already developed already innovated process. So two forms. First is deliberate diversion of resources, which results into generation of knowledge by yourself, and the other is diffusion. Now, in which form is the technical progress occurring will also have different consequences for the growth process. So, if the first effect is happening, that you are generating knowledge by yourself, then the process can be internalized by the innovator for profit. Meaning that suppose I am the one who's researching on something, and who knows that the effect of my research would be so and so, then in my production process itself, in the macroeconomic production process, the effects can be internalized. Second effect is occurring, then it might have complicated implications for technical progress. Why? Because we are really talking about a case of externality. Because suppose I am the one who's developing a technology, and I know that someone else might use it. So I am in a way creating an externality that I am not taking into account while I am creating the technology. So if I know that if suppose there is some kind of innovation that I come up with, and I know that it can be easily copied by someone else, then I might have I am creating an externality, because my sole purpose was not to sort of diffuse this innovation that I am spending my time on. So if that occurs, then I might lose my intention to innovate at the first place, because I know that if I innovate, it becomes freely available to everybody, and then my credit goes into vain. I mean, I am not the exclusive person, or the technology is not unique. So it is possible that if the technical progress is occurring through diffusion, then the story becomes complicated, because it is possible that these externalities that are being created in this transfer process might slow down the rate of deliberate technical progress. One is that it might slow down the rate of deliberate technical progress. Because if people know that, first is that by incentives, people will feel less incentivized to create technologies, because they know that if it can be easily diffused, then at the first place they lose their incentives to create newer technologies. The second is that if people know, if the ones who are practicing in the first method of technical progress, if the ones who are deliberately creating newer technologies, if they know that there is a much more easily available option for them, that is to import technologies from the ones who have already developed, then that will lead to disincentives for them as well, because they might also reduce the production of deliberate technical progress. So the second kind of technical progress that we are talking about here might actually slow down the rate of deliberate technical progress, as well as the progress that is happening through the process of diffusion. So there are a lot of firms that lobby for the protection of IPR, or intellectual property rights, and enforcement of patent laws. And that's the reason why they sort of propagate all these things, is because they want people to feel secured. When they create any kind of innovations, they shouldn't feel that these innovations can be easily copied. So they do, these innovations have patents or rights, copyrights that leads to difficulty in copying these technologies, and there might be a price attached if you want to purchase these kind of technologies or you want to sort of work on these technologies further. So that is why you have these IPRs and so to say not a very perfectly looking market for these technologies, because if you have a perfectly competitive market in technologies, then that might lead to issues as discussed. If it is freely available, if there's a perfectly decided price for these technologies, then that might lead to disincentives both for the ones who are creating it and for the ones who are importing it. So one side of the theory believes in these negative effects. The other believes in the positive effects, that the process of diffusion might actually spur more innovation. Why? Because the ones who are in the categories of leaders, who are the technological leaders, they might feel competitive if someone else is developing a newer technology. So if that competition persists, that suppose I am the one who is one of the fastest, who's one of the top leaders of technological progress, and there's someone else as well in that circle, and I know that someone else is producing a lot, he's coming up with newer and newer innovations and better technologies, then that might sort of incentivize me to be more competitive and create more technologies. So the other positive argument is that this process of diffusion might actually spur more innovation. The negative argument says that it might reduce innovation, because people might first, at the first place, they might feel disincentivized to create more technology, which is that they may not participate in deliberate technical progress because they know that they have easily available technology that can be imported from other countries. And the second kind of disincentives could be for the people who are creating these technologies, because they might feel that the money that they are putting into their research and technology is just easily copied by some other country. So again, the way in which this technical progress is happening also plays a crucial role in deciding the effects of this technical progress in the growth rates. So when we really talk about real world and we move beyond the theories, then these are things that has to be considered. Now, next is the model of deliberate technical progress. So in this chapter, as we just talked about two kinds of methods of technical progress, one is deliberate, wherein you are deliberately choosing to create more technology, and the other is diffusion. So in this section, we are going to talk about the first method, which is the deliberate technical progress. Again, not a very detailed model. It is just to give you an idea of the process. Now, what is really happening here is that we are defining some kind of technology here by Eaton. And we are saying that this is the kind of production that we are really talking about is something called as platonic construction, where we are saying that some of the machines are already there, they already exist, we have blueprints of them, and some of them are still developing. So some of them there's still R&D going on for these technologies. Now, when there is a consistent amount of research and development that's going into the production process, that's leading to an increase in the technical level from you have ET represents the number of machines at an existing date T, and more research and development will lead to extension of this ET to a higher level. So you move to the right of the boundary. If you look at this figure here, 4.2, then you notice that 0 represents that there are no machines. Then ET represents the amount of machines that you have at point T. And then if you move to the right of this boundary, then you can move to the right of the boundary with more and more R&D, with more and more research and development. So moving to the right represents more technological advancements. If you have to incorporate all these effects into a simple production function, this is what it looks like. Now, you have to look at this production function carefully. ET represents the machines. We are, for ease of understanding, we are referring to ET as the
quantity of capital or the total stock of these machines. But in reality, what we really mean by the stock of these machines is the inherent meaning is the state of technical progress, because we are saying that with more and more with more and more machines, we are building on more productivity, and there's more technological advancement with newer machines added into the production process. So inherently, ET represents the state of technical progress. And then you have KT, which is the capital stock at time T. H represents the stock of human capital. But now you will notice that there is a fraction attached to H here, which is small u. Now this small u is the deliberate diversion of present needs with the future needs that we just mentioned in the statement previously. So U basically is the fraction of human capital that is devoted to the production of final goods. Out of the total stock of skilled labor, we are dividing them into two parts. First is U, and the rest will be 1 minus U. So U is basically a fraction. So we are saying that U is the proportion or the share of people of the skilled population that are actually working in the current production process. So this is the production process, this is the current production process producing Y at time period T. And U represents the fraction of people who are actually working in time period T to produce YT. Then we are left with 1 minus U, fraction of skilled population, and we are saying that this 1 minus UH is investing their time into technical progress. So this is the machine sector, so to say, because this is the production sector, and this is the knowledge sector. We have two kinds of sector in this model: one where the current production process is occurring, and one where the future production or future developments in the production process, generation of these developments, is occurring in this sector. So we are devoting a part of the human capital to the current needs, to the current production process, and we are sacrificing a part of the human capital. We are trading this off because they won't be participating in the current production process, but they are spending their time in the knowledge sector to generate more knowledge and to generate more technical progress. So ET plus 1 minus ET by ET, that represents the growth rate of ET, is A times 1 minus U H. A is some constant, some positive constant. 1 minus U, I've just explained to you, it is a fraction of people, fraction of skilled population that is putting their time in R&D or research and development. All right. And the production function, I think, is clear. Because what's really happening in the production function? ET, you already know, ET raised to the power gamma, and the product of this factor basically represents the joint effect of the total stock of machines as well as their productivity. So KT represents the total stock of machines, and ET in a way represents the productivity of these machines. So this together represents the joint effect. And then UH raised to the power 1 minus alpha, you already know what this means. So these are the two kinds of sectors that we have in this model of deliberate technical progress. And then next is the physical capital. So 4.6 represents how ET grows, what is the growth rate of ET, and this 4.7 represents how capital grows. So this is a similar looking equation as the solo model. KT plus 1 minus KT is equal to SYT. Technical progress occurs at some rate given by 4.6, but the point is that the point here is that the right hand side of the equation is not exogenous. Both the stock of human capital in the economy proxied by H and its degree of utilization in R&D affects the rate of technical progress. So what we are really trying to focus here is that the growth rate that you see here, which is the growth rate of technical progress, it is not an exogenous factor in this model. Why not exogenous? Because it is dependent on H and it is dependent on this variable U. So it is dependent on what proportion of people are actually going into the present production process and what proportion of people are going into research and development.
So in that sense, this rate of technical progress becomes endogenous. So both the stock of human capital in the economy, and which is represented by H, and its degree of utilization in R&D affects the rate of technical progress. And it is not merely some technical progress growing at rate G, which was represented by Solow model. So it is not an exogenous technical progress, but an endogenous technical progress. The allocation of human capital between the two sectors, which is basically leading to the trade-off between production today and a better technology tomorrow, is decided by the variable U. If U is higher, then it represents that a lot more percentage of the skilled population is actually in the current production process, and a lesser percentage is in the development of technologies for future. So it depends on the value of U, and how is the value of U being chosen in a society depends on, again, a different complex set of factors. A benevolent government might choose U to maximize some notion of social welfare and attempt to trade off the present benefits of higher production with the potential benefits of future production. So if you're talking about a benevolent government, then they might choose this value U such that it maximizes the social benefits. And social benefits can be maximized if because in that situation you will take into account the future developments. So definitely the U value will come out to be higher, will come out to be lower, because you want to invest into R&D as well. Whereas in most economies, the decision of U is a decision that is jointly made by the government as well as private economic actors. So the government might take into consideration the social welfare aspect, where the government might want the U value to be lesser. But if you rely on private economic actors who are seeking economic gain, then they might want to put a larger proportion of people into the current production process. So the value of U is decided by both the government and the private players, and what is the value of U plays a crucial role in this model, because that will this is the factor that is endogenous, and this is the factor that's explaining the growth rate of technical progress in this model. In such a case, our earlier discussion is relevant. The degree of appropriability of the technology through patent protection and the rate of diffusion of knowledge to outsiders become important factors, because in the absence of these factors, even the private economic actors wouldn't want to invest their time into R&D. Then they would want the U value to be higher. So if there is a presence of patents, or there is a presence of copyrights or protection of the technological developments, then we can expect that together the private economic actors and the government will choose a U value that will maximize the social benefits. As I said, that we are not getting into the details of this model, we are just sort of the chapter just sort of presents different structures. They are just sort of exposing you to the different production setups and the structures of the model, but we are not getting into the intricate details of these models. So I think this is what is there in the discussion of technical progress, the deliberate technical progress. And as we've already discussed, that because of such reasons, we cannot really have, theoretically also, we cannot rely on deliberate allocation of resources. They should allow for some kind of monopolistic power. We can't really have a perfectly competitive looking market for such cases. When we are talking about technology development, then we can't really have a perfectly competitive market. Because if it is a perfectly competitive market, then we know that the freely available new knowledge is costlessly distributed across different participants. And then new knowledge for economic profit would not be produced, because people will have lesser incentives. So we are saying that theories of R&D should allow for some monopolistic power, possibly temporarily, maybe for some time, but they should have. So let's start with section 4.4.4, which is on externalities. Externality is some kind of external effect that one economic agent creates on the other agent, and it could be positive or negative depending on the kind of externality we are talking about. But one very important thing in the aspect of externality is that this external effect that we are really talking about is not internalized in the decisions of the first economic agent who's actually creating the externality. In fact, the one who is taking the effects of the externality, even that economic agent doesn't internalize the effects of this externality. Now, what do we mean when we talk about internalization is that whenever you talk about any economic decision, you talk about the demand side or the supply side, or you basically talk about the equilibrium analysis for a particular individual. Aapne microeconomics mein padha hoga ki koi bhi individual apna decision banane ke liye preferences बजट सेट एंड प्रेफरेंसेस का एक जो पॉइंट होता है जहां पे बोथ ऑफ देम आर टेंजेंशियल, दैट्स द इक्विलिब्रियम पॉइंट. नाउ व्हेन वी टॉक अबाउट एक्सटर्नैलिटी, वी से कि एक्सटर्नैलिटी आर सच काइंड ऑफ इफेक्ट्स जो कि इकोनॉमिक एजेंट अपनी प्रेफरेंसेस में इंटरनलाइज नहीं करता है. दीज आर समथिंग विच आर एक्स्ट्रा एंड हेंस इट इज पॉसिबल दैट द इक्विलिब्रियम दैट इज क्रिएटेड विदाउट टेकिंग दीज एक्सटर्नल इफेक्ट्स इनटू द प्रेफरेंसेस आर डिफरेंट फ्रॉम द इक्विलिब्रियम when you take these effects into consideration. So something called as private equilibrium or social equilibrium, where when you talk about marginal benefits or marginal cost, if I say that the equilibrium will occur at a point where marginal benefits are equal to marginal cost. Now, there could be two kinds of marginal benefits or marginal cost. One is private and the other is social. Private is when I don't take externalities into account. These are decisions that are taken by me privately, and any economic agent doesn't care about whether my action is creating a positive effect or a negative effect on the economy, on the rest of the participants in the economy. Social will be where I consider all these effects. So in the presence of externality, the private equilibrium or specifically private marginal benefit could be different from social marginal benefit. In the absence of externality, the both could be similar, because then we don't really have the difference. If you're not creating any sort of external effect that has not been included in your preferences, then private and social, the difference or the definition becomes almost the same. Unless there are other kinds of things happening. But if there is a presence of externality, if an economic agent is creating some external effect, then the two equilibriums will be different. So, very important feature of externality is that these are effects that are not included in the preferences of the individual, or you can say they are not prized for. So, जब भी आप डिमांड सप्लाई की बात करते हो तो आप बोलते हो कि दिस इज द डिमांड, दिस इज द सप्लाई, एंड आफ्टर टेकिंग इन टू अकाउंट द डिमांड एंड सप्लाई ऑफ वट एवर प्रोडक्ट और सर्विस, यू गेट एन इक्विलिब्रियम प्राइस. बट जब ये डिमांड कर्व आता है, देन अगेन दिस डिमांड कर्व ऑल्सो हैज सम प्रेफरेंसेज. So we are saying that this demand curve doesn't take into account these effects into preferences, and hence these effects are not priced for. They don't have a price, right? So that's a more technical idea of what an externality is. Now, how is externality related to our topic, which is growth theory? What really is the relevance of externality? How is it related to technical progress? And how is it ultimately related to economic growth is what we are going to read in this section. Now, so this is the second model of technical progress that we are again broadly talking about in this chapter. As I said, that the chapter doesn't really dwell into the details of the models that we are covering. It just gives you a broad idea of each model. And that's it. I mean, we don't really get into the intricate details of each of these models. All right, so we try and understand this through an example. So suppose there is an industrialist who invests an enormous amount of money in building a railway line from a mining center to a large port city. This line is basically built to transport ore from the mines, which is presumably owned by the industrialist. So basically the industrialist is sort of
making some investments, and he's creating a railway line from the mining center to the port, to the city with a large port. And obviously the mining center belongs to the industrialist, and he wants to make sure ki mining center se a connectivity bane, so that the raw materials could be transported to different places. So he's investing in this railway line. There is a sleepy town near these mines. Jahan pe ye mines hai, wahin pe aas paas ek chota town hai, through which the railway line passes. Now consider the following scenario. Given that the railway line is present, the town now has access to transport, which will take them to this city, to this large city. And this railway line that is being created between these two parts. So suppose this is the mine, and we are talking about this town near this mine, and then there is another large city jahan se is ye railway line connect kar rahi hai. So basically, jab industrialist ye decision bana raha hai that he wants to create a railway line, he is not taking into account the effects that this creation might have on the residents of these of this town near the mines. But there will definitely be some effects on the people, as they can also access the transport facility. So when the railway line is created, one possibility is that the industrialist could take all the benefits of this railway line by charging an appropriate price for the travel on the line. So when the people from this village access the transport facility, ek possibility hai that this industrialist takes this into account, that he's creating this positive impact on the people, and he can price for this effect. As I just said, that the externalities are not priced for, they don't have a market price, and that's why they are called externality, because they don't have a market price. These are effects that are not taken into consideration by the economic agents. So one possibility is that the industrialist charges some large price from these residents for using the transport line, and hence take out all the benefits that he is, matlab basically jo bhi positive externality wo create kar raha hai, uska wo price bana raha hai, and from that price he is taking all the benefits that he has created. But this is not really possible. We are believing that the government would step in, since this is a kind of a public good that's created by the industrialists. So it's the government will step in, and they will regulate the prices that the industrialists might charge from these people. So the problem will still stay, that the industrialist is creating some positive impact that he did not take into account while making his decision of creating the railway line. So the industrialist has basically created positive externalities for other individuals, and again, the externality term is being emphasized because we are saying that the benefits cannot be fully internalized by the industrialist as extra profits. The benefits that the industrialist is creating are not internalized in his decision equation as extra profits. Now, zaruri nahi hai ki hamesha benefits create ho. It's possible that he is also creating some costs, or basically negative externalities. So what could be the possible negative externalities? Suppose before we talk about negative externalities, the other kinds of indirect positive externalities that are created because of this creation of railway line are, it's also possible that because this railway line has been created, the town now becomes a viable residential area for those who do not wish to live in the big city. So if people do not want to live in the big cities, and they want to transfer themselves to smaller towns, this area becomes a good option to go for, because now people have that access of this town to the big city, so they can enjoy the luxury of staying in a quieter place, but they also have the option of traveling to the big cities. So this becomes a viable residential area, and hence the people who own houses in these areas, their prices will also go up. So the real estate value will go up in this residential town because of the creation of this railway line. So the positive effects are not just created for the people who might use the transport for personal or commercial purposes, but also for other agents, such as people who own houses or people who are in the real estate business. They will also make some profits because of the creation of the railway line. And we can think about many more such positive effects that this economic action would have created on the surroundings. But again, there could also be, besides the benefits, there could also be some costs that this creation might have led to. What could be these costs? So say there is another town that also lies on this line, on the railway line, but there are no railway stations. Suppose there's another town here, and this town also is in the way of this railway line, but is town ke liye koi railway station nahi hai. So the trains do not usually stop, they just go by from this point to this point, so they don't usually stop for this town. So what will be the consequences, or what would be the effects that people in these in this area will face? So they can't use the railway line because the trains do not stop. They don't have a station, and the trains do not stop near this town. They might have negative effects because the residents of the town might have to suffer from increased noise and air pollution because of the presence of the railway line. And they can't even enjoy the better transportation facilities that this town can enjoy. So the industrialist, without taking into account of what positive or negative effects his particular action could have created, has actually created some positive and negative externalities. Now, these positive and negative externalities obviously can distort decision making away from desirable outcomes. As I just said that and in a while we'll also see that how sometimes if you look at these economic decisions from a social perspective, then you might feel that the private equilibrium, the creation of the railway line, has actually distorted the ideal decision making, or maybe what you can call as desirable outcomes. So if you look at it from a social perspective, then the outcomes or the equilibrium that are created when you don't internalize these effects while making your decision can actually not be the desirable outcomes. So since we are talking about, specifically we are talking about technical progress or knowledge development, R&D, capital accumulation, and including both human and physical capital, these external effects can actually lead the economy to make decisions which may not always be desirable outcomes. So again, if we talk about R&D specifically, then we are saying that at an individual level, the externalities of creating knowledge might be negative. For example, a new technical discovery can wipe out the economic power of an existing patent and inflict losses on the patent holder. So at an individual level, agar hum kisi bhi nayi technology ya nayi knowledge production ko assess kare, to it is actually creating negative externalities at an individual level. How? Suppose there's already some kind of technology that's present, right? And this is, let's say, called technology A, and there is this person who owns this technology. Now, if we hypothesize that there is another technology that has just been introduced, technology B, and this is the new innovation in either the process or product or whatever the case may be, and some another person owns this piece of knowledge. Now, at an individual level, the creation of this new knowledge will have negative effects on this person. Why? Because now his technology will become redundant and obsolete, because people might not be interested in his piece of knowledge because now we have a newer piece of knowledge. So if we look at the creation of this
knowledge, then it at an individual level, then we see that they might create negative effects or negative externalities, because this person will lose the power, he will lose the power of his patent, and he will be inflicted with losses. Even at a worldwide level, we can believe that the advancements in knowledge or technology has created some negative effects. So if you talk about nuclear physics, or if you talk about climate change, which we often say that because of the kind of advancements that we are seeing around us, that has led to a lot of other kind of issues, which can be classified as negative externalities. But then the author also tries to balance this discussion out by saying that only an extremely pessimistic individual would argue that on a totality basis or at an aggregate level, the externalities of capital accumulation or new knowledge as well as technological progress have not been overwhelmingly positive. So only a pessimistic individual would say that it is all negative. But in fact, we know that they have also created significant positive externalities. So that's basically the idea of externality in our discussion, that when we really talk about research and development or new advancements, it's possible that the outcome that is being generated is different or is not really the desirable outcome. And after this model, you will realize how that's true. So suppose, just to give you a brief idea of how in the presence of externalities, you can move away from desirable outcomes. So say you have, you are creating some new piece of knowledge is actually creating positive effects. Now, agar ye development ek individual kar raha hai, or maybe when you talk about private individual kar raha hai, that's not really important, but individual is pursuing this with a private motive, meaning that he doesn't take into account the externalities that his action might create. Then it's possible that if we say that the social benefit from his action is greater than the private benefit, as in the previous example, when the industrialist was creating the railway line, then the social benefits from creating the railway line were greater than the private benefits, because he didn't know that just by creating a railway line, besides his business expansion, there could also be other possibilities, like the real estate might grow up, or other people might use the railway line for personal or commercial purposes. So the social benefit from his action was actually greater than the private benefit. And when this is the case, then it's possible ki jitna production ho raha hai private level pe, that is less than the desirable outcome. Now, desirable outcome jab hum bol rahe hain, toh we are really talking about the social outcome, taking into account the effects that a particular action might create on other individuals in the economy. So then in the presence of the externality, the actual production of the product, right? I mean, it could be anything. We basically either, when we talk about the externality in case of R&D, then we are saying that the production of the new knowledge is less than what should have actually been created. So we say that the equilibrium tends to move away from the desirable outcome. So in this case, it will be less than what actually should have been created. If the direction of the effects was opposite, meaning that private benefit was larger than social benefit, which is possible in case of negative externalities. जब negative externalities होंगी तो ऐसा हो सकता है कि जो private benefit हो रहा है उस railway line के creation से जो इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट को बेनिफिट हो रहा है दैट इज लार्जर देन द सोशल बेनिफिट. अगर सपोज वी टॉक अबाउट द अदर टर्म विच नाउ हैज टू यू नो फेस द पोल्यूशन दैट द रेलवे लाइन इज क्रिएटिंग और फेस द नॉइज पोल्यूशन दैट द रेलवे लाइन इज क्रिएटिंग, देन वी कैन आर्ग्यू दैट जितना प्राइवेट बेनिफिट इंडस्ट्रियलिस्ट को हो रहा है दैट इज मच लार्जर देन द सोशल बेनिफिट दैट दिस रेलवे लाइन इज क्रिएटिंग. एंड इन दिस केस द ऑपोजिट विल बी द इफेक्ट दैट द प्राइवेट आउटकम विल बी मोर देन द सोशल आउटकम. तो ओवर प्रोडक्शन हो जाएगा. So desirable outcome is a lesser value, but actual outcome will be higher. So what we are really saying is that in the presence of externalities of a new knowledge or new technology, it's possible that we might, the equilibrium, if we leave this to the private intentions, then the equilibrium might be different from the social equilibrium. So then let's look at this model briefly and try and understand the implications. So we are saying that imagine that an economy is populated with several firms. So ek economy hai jisme bahut sare firms hain aur har firm ka production function aisa dikhta hai 4.8 where y is the output, k is the physical capital, p is the labor employed, and E is the E is some measure of overall productivity, but ET is a macroeconomic parameter that is common to all firms in the economy. So this ET, which is a measure of overall productivity, it is common to all the firms. So chahe wo firm 1 ka production function ho ya firm 2 ka production function ho, this value will stay the same for both these firms. So basically, this is some level of knowledge that is created at a macroeconomic level. This is the overall knowledge creation in the economy. Now, this is a standard growth model, but the twist is that the productivity parameter is neither exogenously specified nor determined by deliberate R&D decisions. So this ET is not really exogenous. Although we are saying that this is common to all the firms, but this is not exogenous, meaning that this is not something that is determined outside the model. It is determined within the model, but the value of this ET is also not reliant on one individual. It is not reliant on one individual firm. So this is not determined by deliberate R&D decisions, but is positive externality generated by the joint accumulation of all the firms in the economy. So ET basically is a summation of all the knowledge that is being created by the entire economy. But the knowledge of the entire economy is affecting each of the firms in the same fashion. So ET is basically something like this, where we say that it is A K star T raised to the power beta, where A alpha and beta, I mean alpha and beta are some positive constants, and K star denotes the average capital stock in the economy. So this is the total capital stock, total average capital stock of the economy. And ET, which is the again total productivity parameter, is also it is dependent on the total amount of capital that is being generated by the firms in the economy. So again, this is not exogenous, kyunki jab aap kisi ek firm ki baat karoge to is ET mein us firm ke capital ka bhi component hoga. So this is not exogenous, and nor it is determined by, this entire value is also not determined by one firm. So this will basically be E1 plus E2 plus so on till EN. So exogenous isliye nahi hai because the firm has its component in the CT, agar hum kisi ek specific firm ki baat kare. And deliberate R&D decisions pe dependent nahi hai ye entirely, because you can only decide, one firm can only decide their, so we are talking about firm 1, output 1, then they can only control E1. They can't control E2, E3 and so on. So this is a kind of model where ET is slightly unique. It is neither entirely exogenous nor entirely decided by the firm, by the individual firm. So basically, this ET is some kind of positive externality that is being generated by the joint capital accumulation of all the firms in the economy. So whether ET will be greater or lesser depends on the kind of externalities that are being created by other firms. So basically, now you can understand that how much capital is being produced by another firm is actually affecting the economic decisions of the other firms in the economy. So if we talk about a model where there are two firms, then firm 1 kitna capital प्रोड्यूस करेगा, दिस इज डिपेंडेंट ऑन कितना कैपिटल फर्म टू ने प्रोड्यूस करा है, राइट? सो इट डिपेंड्स ऑन द काइंड ऑफ एक्सटर्नैलिटी, काइंड ऑफ रिलेशनशिप ऑफ दिस एक्सटर्नैलिटी दैट इज बीइंग शेयर्ड बिटवीन दीज टू फर्म्स. सो 4.10, वी हैव सब्स्टिट्यूटेड दिस इक्वेशन 4.9 इन 4.8. तो ईटी की जगह पे जब ये टर्म रिप्लेस करोगे, दिस इज व्हाट यू गेट, विच इज अल्फा के स्टार टी रेज टू द पावर बीटा के टी. सो रिमेंबर दैट दिस के टी इज द कैपिटल प्रोड्यूस्ड बाय द फर्म इन कंसिडरेशन एंड के स्टार टी इज द एवरेज कैपिटल स्टॉक. नाउ सपोज दैट ऑल दी फर्म्स जितनी भी फर्म्स हैं इकोनॉमी, दे आर बींग ओन्ड बाय अ सिंगल प्लानर एंड वी आर सेइंग दैट दिस इज अ बेनोविलेंट प्लानर. मतलब दिस प्लानर कीप्स इन टू कंसिडरेशन द सोशल इफेक्ट्स. नाउ वेन ऑल दीज फर्म्स आर बींग ओन्ड बाय वन प्लानर हु इज अ बेनोविलेंट प्लानर, देन डेफिनेटली द इफेक्ट्स, पॉजिटिव और नेगेटिव, of the capital creation by each of these firms are being internalized. So this benevolent planner values the capital investment of any one of her firms on the overall productivity of her other firms. So jab ye sare firms ka ownership ek individual ke paas hai and this individual is a benevolent social planner, then कोई भी एक्सटर्नल इफेक्ट, सपोज फॉर्म वन का कोई एक्सटर्नल इफेक्ट हो रहा है बाकी फॉर्म्स पे, दैट इज बीइंग इंटरनलाइज्ड इन दी in the decision of the K star value. But compare this to a scenario where all these firms are privately owned and separately owned. Now in this situation, no firm values the positive externalities that it has on the other firms. So firm 1 jab apna K1 level produce kar raha hai, tab firm 1 ye nahi soch raha that this K1 production might have some positive consequences on K2. And that is not being internalized in his decision. So it's possible that in the presence of positive externalities, the firm might tend to underinvest. As I just told you previously, that when there is a presence of positive externality, then the marginal private benefits are less than the marginal social benefits. Aur kyunki firm 1 in social benefits ko apne decisions mein internalize nahi kar raha, he is not considering the profits that it might generate. So basically, agar isko thoda aur analyze karo, so when K1 is increasing, then in your production function, this is increasing, right? KT is increasing. But when K1 is increasing, suppose we say that increase in K1 has a positive effect on K2. So agar K1 increase ho raha hai, to K2 bhi increase hoga. अगर K2 इंक्रीज हो रहा है, सो इन अ वे K स्टार इज ऑल्सो इंक्रीजिंग बिकॉज K1 प्लस K2 इज नथिंग बट K स्टार. सो दिस इंक्रीज इन K1 हैज बेसिकली टू इफेक्ट्स. वन इज दैट इट इज लीडिंग टू डायरेक्ट इफेक्ट, ज्यादा K1 प्रोड्यूस हो रहा है फॉर द फॉर्म 1 एंड बिकॉज फॉर्म 1 इज प्रोड्यूसिंग मोर कैपिटल, इट इज पॉसिबल दैट इट माइट क्रिएट पॉजिटिव एक्सटर्नैलिटी ऑन द अदर फॉर्म्स एंड दे माइट ऑल्सो क्रिएट मोर कैपिटल. एंड इफ अदर फॉर्म्स आर क्रिएटिंग मोर कैपिटल, देन दिस के स्टार वैल्यू विल ऑल्सो इंक्रीज, विच विल फर्दर हैव बेनिफिट्स फॉर फॉर्म 1. सो ये जो एक्स्ट्रा प्रॉफिट्स हैं because of the positive externality are not being internalized in his decision of producing K1. So it's possible that he might underinvest. Jitna actual K1 firm 1 ko produce karna chahiye, shayad wo usse kam karega because the private benefits are less than the social benefits. So in the presence of positive externalities, the firms might tend to underinvest in capital accumulation relative to what will be planned by the benevolent planner. अगर ये सारे firms किसी एक benevolent planner के ownership में हैं, then K1 might be larger than what it will be when a private separate individual will decide its value. And in the case of negative externalities, the opposite will happen. That is the first implication of positive externalities, which is that underinvestment might happen if private ownership or separate ownership is given to each of these firms. The second implication of positive externality is fundamentally related to the growth model, which is that the observation that constant returns at the level of firm can coexist with increasing returns at the level of society. So constant returns at the level of firm, at the level of the individual firm, because we know that if you look at the firm production function, Then these are the two form of factor of production that we are taking into account. And if you look at this production function, then alpha plus 1 minus alpha, if you try and calculate the returns here, you will find that this is a constant returns to scale production function. But we are saying that in the presence of positive externalities, constant returns to scale at the firm level can coexist with increasing returns at the level of society. So if you look at the production function and you try to substitute change the production function a bit by assuming that if we are believing that the production function of a benevolent planner, from the perspective of a benevolent planner, then K star T will actually be equal to KT. So substituting this in the production function, we will find this change, which is that when K star becomes KT, then the exponents of K will become alpha plus beta, because KT star had alpha and K had beta. Now we are saying that when a benevolent planner is there in the picture, then the production function will become such that KT is equal to KT star. And then from the economic, from the economy, from the aggregate point of view, where one person is controlling all the set of firms, then this is the kind of production function that we'll have. And now in this production function, you can see that this will be increasing returns to scale, because now we have, believing that beta is positive, this will have increasing returns to scale, because now when you try and look at the returns to factors of production here, you will have alpha plus beta plus 1 minus alpha, which will give you 1 plus beta, right? So believing that beta is positive, it is non-negative, we can say that this production function will exhibit increasing returns to scale. So we are saying that that the economy or generation of output has increasing returns to scale, and we now know the implications of increasing returns to scale, that the growth levels will increase. Exactly, is complementarity. So this is a particular type of externality which can coexist with positive and negative effects. But the difference between this externality is that between this externality and the positive and negative externality is that it doesn't relate to the level of utility or monetary reward that others experience when a particular action is taken, but it relates to the ranking of alternatives that they have. That is the notion of complementarity. So what we are already saying is ki jab hum positive or negative externality ki baat karte hain, to hum bolte hain ki if there are two agents, to ek agent ke action ki wajah se dusre agent pe kitna positive impact ho raha hai ya negative impact ho raha hai. We talk about it in terms of level of utility, whether the utility of other individual is increasing, and if increasing by how much amount, if decreasing then by how much amount. That is the concept of positive and negative externality. But complementary is another kind of externality that happens because of actions taken by one agent, and it somehow affects the other agent, but not in terms of level, but in terms of rankings. So suppose individual 2 had some options, some economic decisions. Let's say decision A, decision B, decision C. There were three decisions that he could have taken, that he has the option of taking. And because of the action of agent 1, jo teen actions he has in his list, what the ranking of these three options might change. So say initially, without the effect of agent A, or agent 1, the rankings were such, A was greater than B was greater than C, meaning that his priority was to perform A, then B, and then C. But because of the action of agent 1, this ranking might change to, just a hypothetical example, might change to this. So complementarity is a kind of externality that changes the ranking of alternatives that the other agent has. Whereas positive negative externality basically relate with the positive impact and the negative impact of this particular action on agent 2. We don't really talk about the levels of rankings in positive and negative case. We only say ki ek particular action se individual 2 ki utility pe positive impact hoga, kitna positive impact hoga aur kitna negative impact hoga. We don't really say ki is positive or negative impact ki wajah se agent 2 ke decision mein kya farak padega ya jitne alternatives agent 2 ke paas hai unki ranking mein kya farak padega. That is what is true and in the case of complementarity. Now, this idea of complementarity is quite relevant to our discussion, current discussion, which is that suppose an individual firm is making its decision regarding capital accumulation. To do this, it must forecast its future productivity given equation 4.10, which is this equation, jisme definitely मल्टीपल फॉर्म्स का डिसीजन मैटर करता है इवन फॉर एन इंडिविजुअल फॉर्म. द प्रोडक्टिविटी डिपेंड्स ऑन द फ्यूचर पाथ ऑफ एवरेज कैपिटल अक्यूमुलेशन बाय ऑल फॉर्म्स. तो किसी एक इंडिविजुअल फॉर्म की प्रोडक्टिविटी डिपेंड्स ऑन द एवरेज कैपिटल अक्यूमुलेटेड बाय ऑल द फॉर्म्स इन द इकोनॉमी. If this path is predicted by a firm to be swiftly climbing, the firm will believe that its future productivity will also rise at a correspondingly high pace. So if the firm expects, if one individual firm expects that the average capital stock is increasing, or basically it is increasing over time, with each passing time period, the average capital stock is increasing. If that is the kind of belief that this firm one has, then this firm one will also increase its capital in the current time period. So it is possible that under such expectations about the future, each firm will be more willing to trade off their current consumption to with future profits, which means that by allocating, by investing a larger amount of capital today, they might lose their current consumption, but in the future they can expect to earn more profits. So definitely there's a trade-off when you are investing in capital in the current time period. It's possible that you might lose some profits in the current time period, but by investing in more capital, you can expect to earn more profits in the future. So it is a trade-off of current consumption with future consumption or future profits. So when the firm expects that other firms are also going to increase their capital accumulation, firm one will also accumulate more capital. And this is the kind of complementarity that we are really talking about, that the fact that a single individual takes some action increases the incentives for others to take the same action is called as complementarity. Because the other firms, jo baki ki firms hai economy mein, they are also increasing their capital. Because of this action of other firms, firm one is also incentivized or motivated to increase its capital accumulation or to trade off its current consumption with future consumption. In the present example, we are talking about the case of positive externality. But remember that there's a big difference between externality and complementarity. So it doesn't matter whether we are talking about positive or negative externalities. What we are really talking about is whether these externalities are getting translated into complementarities or not, whether these externalities are converting themselves into actions. So aisa ho sakta hai that it is possible that you have positive externalities in the economy, which is that it's possible that when other firms are producing more capital, firm one has positive externality. Because positive externality kyun hoga, kyunki aur baki firms agar zyada capital produce kar rahi hain to k star value zyada hogi to definitely firm one pe positive externality hogi. But this is the case of positive externality. But because of this positive externality, whether firm one chooses to increase its capital stock or
decrease or keep the capital stock constant is what is important. So agar firm one incentivize hota hai to produce more capital, then we say that it is a case of complementarity. Ye zaruri nahi hai ki positive externality ki presence mein firm one will always choose to produce more. Right? It's possible that despite knowing that there are positive externalities, firm one might not choose to produce more and might keep the capital constant. So, complementarity is basically when you actually recreate the effects of the externality into actions. Matlab, aapki alternatives change ho rahe hain, aapki ranking change ho rahi hai. Aur ranking is tarike se change ho rahi hai that your action is in sync with the effects of the positive or negative externality. So here they are also giving another example, where is that it is possible that one individual inflicts positive externalities on all others by driving safely. So on a particular road, it is very important that everybody drives safely to avoid any kind of accident. So say one individual is inflicting some positive externalities by driving safely, but this does not necessarily mean that others will also drive safely. So if there are multiple individuals on the road, by one individual making sure that he will drive safely, he is creating positive externalities on all other individuals in the on the road, right? But this is the case of positive externality. But whether these other individuals will also drive safely or not is a matter of complementarity. So it is possible that in the presence of positive of or negative externalities, complementarities may be absent. That's completely true. So it's possible that despite knowing that agent 1 is driving safely, it's possible that agent 2, 3, 4 and 5 or other agents may not drive safely. They may not comply. But both the situations are possible where complementarities are present or the other case where they are not present. So the distinction between positive negative externalities and complementarity has to be clear. Positive or negative externalities refer to the level of satisfaction. Kitna satisfaction change ho raha hai dusre individuals ka. Whereas complementarity refers to increased relative preferences that others experience for choosing similar actions because you acted in a particular way. Because one agent has acted in a particular way, what are the changes that it might create in the relative preferences of other individuals? Right? I hope the idea is clear, but just to make it more relatable for you guys, suppose in a class test, there are 40 students sitting for the class test, right? And one individual decides to, he hasn't prepared for the test, he or she hasn't prepared for the test, and he decides to cheat from another person's copy, right? Now, what is the case of positive negative externality? The action of this agent, of this student, deciding to cheat in the class test will have negative externalities for the other person as well, right? Because if he's cheating from person 2, then the teacher wouldn't know who has cheated from whom, and the teacher might decide to give equal marks to or give penalties to both these individuals in similar fashion, right? So his action will definitely have, will reduce the level of satisfaction of this individual. But and it's possible ki negative externalities hain, ye janne ke baad individual 2 might decide to not participate or not participate in this action. So complementarity, he might decide, he has two options, agent 2 has two options, to cheat or to not cheat, right? We are saying ki agar agent 1 ek particular action karta hai, agent 1 ke paas bhi dono options hain, to cheat or not cheat, but his relative preference of cheating is more than not cheating, so he decides to cheat. And when he decides to cheat, he's creating some externalities for the other individual which are negative, because if he cheats from agent 2,
then both of them will get the same penalty. Now, so that is the negative externality that is being created. But complementarity tab hogi is action ki jab agent 2 will also decide to cheat. That is complementarity, that because his relative preferences are more for cheating, that is also disturbing the relative preferences of agent 2. And agent 2 also decides ki I will also cheat. So this is what we are really talking about. But it's also possible that despite knowing that there could be externalities, this person might decide not to cheat. So whether it will lead to a complementary action or not is not certain. Positive or negative externalities hoegi hi hoegi of a particular action, but how will that externality affect the relative preferences of the other individual is important, and that is what guides the concept of complementarity. Our growth model, then let's say that each firm decides to choose its saving rate, and believing that saving rate is detrimental for growth process. So say each firm is choosing the saving rate and translated appropriately, what we have shown is that each firm believes that the average savings rate in the economy is high. If the average savings rate, so just in our equations of K star and KT, just say that instead of KT you have, so if you have more savings, basically that will get translated into more investments and further more K star values. So we are just taking savings rate as the parameter, but you can imagine how this savings rate will affect the K star values or K values in the equations that we have just seen. So if the average savings rate in the economy is high, we can say that the projected path of its productivity, of the firm's own productivity, will be higher, and it's possible that if it participates in a complementary action, it will also choose a larger value of S. Let's look at figure 4.3, which represents this idea of complementarity graphically. We need to complete the story by recognizing that the average rate of investment is not something that's exogenous, but is itself the average outcome of all individual investment choices, which we've already discussed that this ET parameter is not an exogenous parameter. It is actually an endogenous parameter, because each firm will have its component in this parameter of ET. Alright, so let's look at 4.3. Now, 4.3 also tells you that how important is the role of economic beliefs in deciding any equilibrium, specifically when we are talking about this broader idea of externality. So, this is a graph where you have individual investment rates on the y-axis, and this is the economy-wide anticipated. This is the key word, economy-wide anticipated investment rates. So on the x-axis, you have the expected average savings rate with which each firm will have. Now, each firm can have different expectations of what is the economy-wide anticipated investment rates and how the difference in this expectation will result into actuality is what we will see here. So this 45 degree line is the line of equilibrium, where the economy wide investment rate becomes equal to the individual investment rate, and this curve that you see here, which is a mix of concave and convex function, you see that this is basically the relationship between the average investment rate and the individual investment rate. So you see that as it increases, if the economy wide investment rate increases, then the individual investment rate also increases. The only difference is that initially it increases at an increasing rate and then it increases at a decreasing rate, but it is all through it is increasing, right? So this is the kind of relationship, and we say that at these points,
at point S1 and at point S3, we reach equilibrium, because these are the points where the individual investment rate will be equal to the economy-wide anticipated investment rate. Remember that these are not the actual investment rates that the economy might be making. These are the expected investment rates that individual or firm one has. So if I believe, if I am the firm in consideration, and if I say, if I believe that on an average, the economy is saving 20%, then I might also decide to save 20% because I have that expectation of the other firms in the economy. So my equilibrium will be achieved when my actual reaction or actual action will coincide with the expectation of the average savings rate in the economy. So these points here where this curve intersects with the 45 degree line, at 45 degree line x axis is equal to y axis, these will be the points of equilibrium. And now you have two equilibriums here, one is S1 and the other is S2. S1 is a point of low savings rate and S2 is a point of high savings rate. Now realize that these two equilibriums are only differentiated by the beliefs that the firm one had about the anticipated investment rates. So if the firm one has a higher belief, has a belief that the economy will save a higher proportion, then the actual reaction will also be higher. But on the other hand, if the firm believes that the economy is saving lesser, then it might also decide to save lesser. And I'm not sure if you have read this, but in economics, there are a lot of theories and a lot of models which are built on expectations. And we also say that expectations are self-fulfilling, meaning that if firm 1 expects that the savings rate of the economy are lesser, if it is S1, then firm 1 will also decide to save S1. Now, when firm 1 saves S1, then the other firms, say firm 2, firm 3, they might also believe that the economy-wide average savings rate is lesser, and they might also save a lesser amount. So we will ultimately land up in a situation where the overall savings rate is lesser, because, and this has happened only because of the expectations that the average savings rate is lesser. It's also possible that we could have led ourselves in this situation where investment rates are higher, just by believing that the economy-wide investment rates are higher. So when we talk about an actual economy, these interactions between different individuals play a crucial role, and the kind of expectations that each individual, each economic agent will have is also very important in deciding the actual position of the economy. So it's possible that different similar economies, say these are two equilibriums of different economies. We can say that two economies which otherwise look similar, if we really talk about it in terms of the Solow model, say all the parameters, the population, the technology, and all of these parameters, depreciation, are similar across these economies, but the beliefs in these economies are different. And again, what are the factors that are guiding these beliefs is a different story altogether. Why did individual one at the first place believe that the overall average investment in the economy is lesser is a different story altogether. But say that there are two economies which otherwise look similar, but they have different beliefs. And just by having different beliefs, different economic beliefs, the actual equilibrium in these economies could be different, just as depicted here in this graph. So when we talk about externalities, when we talk about the role of external effects in the production function, when we bring that aspect in the production function, then this is the whole story of it. We are specifically talking about a model where we are considering ET, which is something that is an aggregate production function, which is an aggregate technology parameter into a production function. And by including that idea in our production function, how things will change, how it will affect the actual savings rate and further technology is
is the kind of story that we are trying to build in this section. Moving to the last section, which is total factor productivity. So far we've talked about technical progress from different conceptual angles. We've talked about the idea of diffusion, we've talked about the idea of deliberate accumulation of human capital or of knowledge. We talked about the model of deliberate capital accumulation. Then we have talked about how externalities could play an important role in deciding the technological progress of an economy. Now, in this section, we are going to briefly talk about how to measure this progress. And we are introducing this term, total factor productivity, and we say that this is a measure of technical progress. So, say you have a typical production function where YT represents output, YT is a function of KT, which is physical capital, PT depicts the labor force, and ET is some measure of knowledge at date T. Published data will yield estimates of Y, K and P. You don't really have data on ET. You don't have direct measures of getting the value of ET. Because it, since it represents the state of knowledge, it cannot be directly measured. Now, how do we actually then, if we cannot directly measure ET, then how do we estimate the proportion of growth in output that is attributed to ET? Meaning that if output is growing at say 10%, then how much of this 10% is because of ET, how much of this 10% is because of labor force or because of capital is important to understand. How do we measure that is through total factor productivity, and in this section we'll see how we can further break this down. Since we do not have data on ET, then again it becomes important to ask then if we don't have data on ET, how do we measure this particular parameter? So imagine that we are excluding ET from our production function and we are only taking the role of K and P. Now we can say that in terms of difference equation, we can say that delta YT is equal to, this is Euler's theorem if you have read about it in maths, delta YT will be equal to marginal product of capital into delta K plus marginal product of labor into delta P, right? From this equation, if I say that this is just a function of K and P, in reality it is a function of K, P and E, but because we don't have measures of E, we are restricting it to the function of K and P. And I can say that change in Y will be equal to marginal product of capital into delta K plus marginal product of labor into delta P. Now what we are doing here is that we are dividing both sides of this equation by YT. So dividing both sides by YT, and further on the right hand side, so on the right hand side you will have MPK into delta K by YT. Now to this term you are multiplying and dividing by KT. So by dividing it by YT you will have MPK into delta K by YT, but to further simplify this you are multiplying and dividing this term by KT. So you will have something like this. Similarly, to the second term, you divide it by YT, but you further multiply and divide this with PT, right? So you are multiplying this with PT and you are also dividing this by PT. Next, how will this equation then change? So on the left side, you have delta Y by Y. We have introduced two new parameters here, which are theta k and theta p. What do these terms represent? So theta k is nothing but mpk into kt by yt. That is the share of capital income in the total income. And theta p is mpl into p by y, which represents the share of labor income in the total income. These are the income shares. Theta k and theta p are the income shares of capital and labor. Now, why are they the income shares? They can be the income shares only under the assumption of constant returns to scale and perfect competition. Because we say that in perfect competition, very basic economics will tell you that in case of perfect competition, the prices of capital and labor are equal to their marginal products, right? So each unit of labor will be paid a wage rate equal to the marginal product of labor. So if say you have one amount of labor, then you will be paying MPK times, you will be paying this amount MPK to one unit of labor. To PT, if the total amount of labor force in your economy is P, then the total amount of labor income will be MPK into P. And this will only happen, wage rate being equal to MPK will only happen if the market is perfectly competitive. So this assumption has to be kept in mind, right? This will be MPK into P. This will represent the total income. If you divide total labor income, if you divide this total labor income, which is MPK into P, by Y, then it will tell you ki total income mein se kitna share labor income ko ja raha hai. Right? So if I say that Y is total income and it can only be divided between K and P, then MPK into P, which is the total labor income divided by Y, will tell you the share of total income going to labor. Similarly, MPK into K by Y will tell you the share of total income going to K, and that is what theta K and theta P represents. So in this equation, we have substituted these terms with theta K and theta P. So the equation will change to delta Y by Y is equal to theta K into delta K by K plus theta P into delta P by P. You will notice that the actual production function was actually a production function of K, P and E. So in this equation, when you actually estimate this equation with real data, it's possible that the left hand side doesn't come out to be equal to the right hand side. And there will be a gap between the left hand side and the right hand side, and this difference is nothing but growth in total total factor productivity. Remember that this is not the level of total factor productivity, this is the growth rate. Why growth rate? Because if you look at these equations here, they are in terms of growth. Delta Y by Y is the growth rate in Y. Delta K by K is also the growth rate in K. So these are all this equation is now translated into a growth equation. So if the left hand side doesn't come out to be equal to the right hand side, then any difference between left and the right hand side is explained by total factor productivity. So although we cannot measure the level of E directly from the data, by estimating the equation and by only taking into account capital and labor, which can be directly measured, the residual or the left amount is considered to be the effect of total factor productivity. So if left hand side is greater than the right hand side, then we say that total factor productivity growth is positive. If it is negative, then we say that total factor productivity growth is negative. Then you have certain points that have to be kept in mind when we are talking about total factor productivity. First is that the concept of TFP level is opposed to growth is not important. The level carries no information at all. The level of total factor productivity carries no information. What matters is that how this level changes over time. So as in the equation, you are estimating the growth rate of total factor productivity. So the level information is not that important. What is really important is that how is this level changing? How is this level of knowledge changing? How, at what level is it growing? Second is that when you are measuring increases in PT, you have to be careful that PT doesn't represent the total population. It represents the labor force. One standard method is to simply proxy this by the rate of population growth, but that proxy may not be right in all cases, because specifically for countries where the participation rate in the labor force has significantly altered over time. So it's possible in some countries, it's possible that the entire population, a significant part of this population, is in the labor force, and hence you can use the proxy measure of population growth similar to the, I mean, you can use this as a proxy variable for the growth in labor force. But for countries, so say this is labor force and this is the total population, if the difference is marginal, and then in that case you can use population as representative of the labor force. But in countries where the participation rate of labor force is less, or probably that has been changing over time, in these cases you can't take population as a proxy measure of the labor force. So you need to be very careful when you talk about P here. P doesn't represent the total population, it only represents the amount of labor force in the economy. Third, that the concept of aggregate capital stock and aggregate labor force may be useful in theoretical exposition, but in practice we need to aggregate stocks. We may need to aggregate stocks of capital that are growing at different rates. This can be done by exercising aggregate capital growth as the weighted sum of different subgroups of capital, much in the same way that we express aggregate output growth as a weighted sum of capital and labor. So we are saying that right now in this equation we represent K as the aggregate capital stock and P as the aggregate labor stock. But it is possible that in reality, as a theoretical model, it is fine because you don't want to get into complexities. But in practice, when you are actually estimating this equation, capital could then be categorized into different subcategories. So in reality, you might want to represent aggregate capital stock as a weighted sum of these different subcategories of capital. Similarly, for labor, you might want to segregate this into different subcategories and then represent it as a weighted sum of all of these. Finally, the methodology might run into problems. So this idea of measuring total factor productivity by taking the residual might run into a problem if the assumptions aren't true. So we assume that it is the production function is following constant returns to scale and the market is perfectly competitive. If that is not true, then the factors of production wouldn't be paid their marginal products, and we cannot then build this model and estimate total factor productivity from the equation. Because the basic assumption here is that labor is paid marginal product to labor and capital is paid marginal product to capital. But that's only possible if you believe that we are in a perfectly competitive market setup. If we are not in a perfectly competitive market setup, and if that assumption is not true, then we cannot estimate total factor productivity through this method. So this is what we have from this section on total factor productivity.